In this video, you'll learn about frequency response graphs and specifications for audio equipment. You'll also become aware of a trick that some manufacturers use that can make frequency response specs a bit deceiving. But if you're new to this channel, welcome. My name is Kyle. If you want to learn audio production online, subscribe to Audio University. When shopping for a microphone, studio monitors, or a pair of headphones, you'll probably be comparing several sets of technical specifications to decide which one best suits your needs. One of the most important specifications is frequency response. If you missed part one of this series, click here to quickly learn what frequency response is and why it's important. In part one, you learned that the frequency response of a device can affect the frequency balance of a signal passing through that device. A frequency response graph helps us to visualize this. The x-axis shows frequency. Lowest frequencies on the left, highest frequencies on the right. The y-axis shows level. Lowest level on bottom, highest level on top. A straight line from left to right indicates that every frequency can pass through the device equally. This is often called a flat frequency response. A device with a perfectly flat frequency response can pass a signal from its input to its output without affecting the frequency balance of that signal. However, a perfectly flat frequency response is very rare. Let's take a look at the frequency response graph for the Shure KSM-9. Some frequencies are accentuated by this microphone, other frequencies are reduced. Frequency response graphs are very useful when comparing one microphone to another. Let's compare the frequency response graphs of a Shure KSM-9 to that of a Shure SM58. You can see that the KSM-9 accentuates more high frequencies, but reduces more low frequencies in comparison to the SM58. This indicates that the KSM-9 has a brighter sound, but the SM58 has a more accurate low frequency response. Frequency response graphs are the most valuable way to interpret frequency response because they not only show the frequency range, but they show the relative level within that range. Often, technical specifications don't include a frequency response graph. In this case, frequency response might be shown like this. This style of specifying frequency response includes stating the frequency range in addition to this very important piece of information called the tolerance. The tolerance tells us the maximum deviation in level along the stated frequency range. This specification indicates that the JBL-308P studio monitor is capable of reproducing frequencies within the range of 45 Hz to 20 kHz without deviating more than plus or minus 3 decibels. When a tolerance isn't stated, the frequency range alone is very vague. A speaker might be capable of passing frequencies from 20 Hz to 20 kHz, but without a stated tolerance, you could be unaware of terrible peaks and dips that might exist along that range. While a tolerance of plus or minus 3 decibels is often assumed when nothing is specified, this isn't always the case. In fact, some manufacturers intentionally leave this detail out in a way to embellish the capabilities of a product. Be aware of this tactic. In the next video, you'll learn how frequency response specifications are measured. If you got value out of this video, hit the like button and share the video. For more content like this, subscribe to Audio University and check out the website at audiouniversityonline.com. Thanks for watching.